We're focusing on all six components of the rotator cuff, and we're moving now into the sagittal projection and how to use it. Let me do a little drawing for you first. You know, as you move from medial to lateral, and I'll make a humeral head that's in pink, and let's pretend we're about over here. We're about at this location. At that location, you're going to see a fair amount of muscular tissue. And the reason you don't see any muscular tissue here is because the cuff is ruptured. So don't be worried that you don't see a coronally. But in a normal shoulder, you'll see some muscular tissue, which I'll make orange. And then within that muscular tissue, which will include several different muscles, the supraspinatus and infraspinatus, you're going to see some individual tendon subunits. Now, as we get a little further over, and I'll show you where we are, we're going to pretend we're over here, then things look a lot different. So now we'll make a humeral head, and what does it look like now? Now things flatten out, and they become much darker. You may see multiple round spots near each other, or they may be one contiguous black band. And then you'll often see a little bit of lighter signal right there, usually in the posterior one-third or middle third of the humeral head. And that signifies that you're making the leap or transition to the infraspinatus, even though we all know now that there's quite a bit of interweaving and interdigitation between the fibers of these two structures. So we'll make our infraspinatus in purple. And because it has a steeper radius of curvature, it often looks a little more like little hairs coming in than the supraspinatus, which looks more like a flat black structure. And we have discussed this previously in some of our vignettes. So now let's go to our sagittal. So let's reinvent ourselves here. And you can see from my line that this sagittal is out near the periphery or far edge of the humeral head. And to quote a famous author, where's the beef? There is no beef. There's no supraspinatus, just a ragged fiber remnant that's lying in a hole. There's no infraspinatus. There is a sick, swollen teres, and there are some sick, irregular-looking infraspinatus fibers. We've got a bald humeral head. And I've got on the right side the T1 weighted image to match it. Now, one potential pitfall that you've got to be very cognizant of is the underbelly or undersurface of the deltoid. Sometimes you'll see a little bit of coalescence of the tendon. Not in this example, but if the deltoid is sagging down or sitting down on the humeral head, you're actually looking at that tendon and you will confuse it for an intact cuff. It happens all the time. So don't get fooled by that. But let's continue scrolling now. We'll go out to the side. We've got nothing. A little bit of teres. We start working our way medially. We still got nothing. And we should be running into the biceps about now. And we do, right there. There's our biceps. Let's follow our biceps in. There goes our biceps. So our biceps is present. It's accounted for. But although you don't know this from this vignette, it's also subluxed. But that's a story for a different vignette. There is the coracohumeral ligament, one component of it. The intra-articular component. In another vignette, you would have seen that the extra-articular component is already ruptured. But I'm showing it for the supraspinatus, which is nowhere to be found, the infraspinatus, which is also nowhere to be found, and finally, the subscapularis, which is found. There is the robust superficial portion of the subscap, but the deeper fibers of the subscap, let me blow it up a little bit, these deeper fibers here, and these deeper fibers right here, which should be flush on the lesser tuberosity, and they're not. They're replaced by inflammatory fibrous tissue and or scar. You see directly above it the position of the biceps. So we have firmly established that the supraspinatus is ruptured all the way from front to back, all the way from anterior to posterior. See if I can blow it up for you rather quickly. Well, there we go. So all the way from anterior to posterior, it's torn. So it's a complete tear. Completeness is length. The infraspinatus torn all the way from anterior to posterior. It's a complete tear. And the subscapularis is demonstrating a partial thickness undersurface tear. The sagittal, invaluable in telling you the front to back length of tears and in identifying and qualifying subscapularis tears.